Harper and Harper Audio present You Only Live Once, David Bravo by Mark Oshiro. Performed by Avi Roque. To all adopted kids everywhere, this one's for you. Tuesday, September 5th, 8:10 a.m. The first day of middle school. What if we just don't go to school? I'm standing next to Antoine Harris, who's got his thumbs looped behind the straps of his backpack. His mom left the two of us here, staring at the steps that lead up to the entrance of Miramonte Middle School. Other kids are rushing up them before the first bell rings. But the two of us, we're not moving at all.
That's a really good idea, David, says Antoine. But what are we going to do all day?
I scratch at my chin. We could walk to Target. Antoine raises an eyebrow at me.
Target?
I already came up with a perfect cover story, I say. We were hired by Lego to assemble the display models.
Okay, but I get all the Star Wars ones.
I put my hands up. They're all yours. I'll be busy assembling that huge fire station set they have.
That's a good plan, says Antoine, smirking,
but then he turns back to those daunting steps. He sighs.
It can't be that bad, can it?
We don't have any classes together, I whine.
And we have classes, Antoine says, frowning. I don't get why we can't still have the same teacher all day.
Whoever made up the idea of middle school is evil, I say. We should turn around right now and head straight to the Legos. Antoine hesitates, then scratches his scalp between two of the intricately braided cornrows he just got a few days ago.
I think my parents would be mad if I didn't show up to the first day of school.
Well, of course, I say. But think how excited they'll be to find out we've been hired by Target to put together all their Lego sets. He laughs at that.
How about this? He says. Let's regroup at lunch. At least then we don't have to become cliches and worry about where we're going to sit.
Excellent plan, I say. No after-school specials about us. And then, the handshake. We slap the backsides of our hands against each other's twice. Crisscross, we say in unison. A dap, mine on top first, then his. Always floss. Because we both care about dental hygiene, okay? We grip each other's hands, but only at the fingers.
Always friends.
Then we pull our hands apart, so fast that it makes a little snapping sound. To the end. Antoine bumps his shoulder against mine as the two of us ascend the stairs to Miramonte Middle School. I don't know what our first day of seventh grade will hold, but at least my best friend is at my side. And then, for the first time since we met in first grade when his family moved here from Virginia, Antoine veers off, waving, and heads to a different class than mine. I have this urge to chase after him, but I don't.
No, David, I tell myself,
and I stop walking just short of the front gate.
You just have to make it to lunch.
I can do that. I think. But maybe not. I don't like new things like surprises or anything that interrupts my routines. Starting at this new school feels like a million surprises and interruptions all wrapped into one giant mess. I breathe in. I breathe out. A part of me wants to give in to the sensation sneaking up on me and just freeze. I do that sometimes. Especially when I'm overwhelmed.
There's also a bigger part of me that doesn't want to be the weirdo standing outside the school when the first bell rings. So I make myself keep going, past the iron front gate, and I join the stream of students at Miramonte Middle School, walking into the uncertain and the unknown. Tuesday, September 5th, 8:15 a.m. First class. Not the fancy seats in an airplane, unfortunately. I reach into my pocket and pull out the folded piece of paper I stuffed in there earlier. I have all six of my classes marked in color-coded ink. But somehow, I forgot to include classroom numbers. So I know I have social studies first, but absolutely no idea where it is. Oh, this is going to be fun. I move to the side as a river of more kids pours into campus. Mom and Dad brought me here a week ago for orientation, but they didn't give us a tour. And this place is like a never-ending maze. At least I'm not going to the other middle school, La Sierra Junior High, all the way on the other side of town. That has to be the ugliest campus I've ever seen. I'm already sweating as I rush up to the closest building. It's always so warm here in California that our schools are made up of several buildings, spread out from one another. Antoine told me that his old school out in Virginia was a single building because it got snowy and cold during the winter. To be honest, the design of our schools here makes no sense to me. Who wants to be outside when it's super hot? Like right now. The sign on the side of the building reads, Mathematics. A drop of sweat runs right into the side of my eye. This is the worst. I turn around and thankfully spot a sign that says, History and Social Studies, on the building across the way. I unfortunately have to cut through a bunch of kids to get there, which earns me numerous dirty looks. Relief floods me when I see a paper tacked to an open door with the name of the teacher I'm looking for. I walk into Mr. Bradshaw's class, room 213, and am immediately faced with another choice to make. Where do I sit?
Welcome, students, says Mr. Bradshaw, a tall white man with a shiny bald spot in the middle of his gray and white hair. Please choose where you sit carefully. That will be your seat for the remainder of the year.
More students shuffle in. Tall, brown, black, white, Asian, short, chubby, awkward, loud, and desks are disappearing quickly. I think about sitting next to the girl in the front row with the freckles and pigtails, but the empty desk beside her is claimed while I hesitate. Do I quickly make a decision before more desks are occupied? Oh, absolutely not. There are only two left by the time I dart over to the rear corner and sit next to an Asian girl who slams a notebook shut as soon as I turn to her. Hi, she says, a nervous edge to her voice. Gracie, I wasn't doing anything. I blink a few times at her. Okay, I say. I'm David. She smiles but turns away. Well, that happened. I put my backpack on the floor to my left, then pull out my own notebook and a pen. I don't actually know what I'm supposed to be doing. Antoine's older brother, Isaiah, told me when he visited over the summer that middle school was going to be a big change for me. You'll have homework all the time, he explained. And be prepared to have to take notes. I'm not really sure what that actually means. What am I supposed to note? What the teacher is wearing? The things he says? Everything he says? Everything I'm thinking? Wow, this is a lot already, and class hasn't even started. The bell rings, and right as it does, the last two kids come tumbling into class. I don't need to be a middle school expert to know that I will not be friends with them. They're slugging each other in the shoulder repeatedly. The taller and browner of the two,
who honestly looks like he's at least in high school, sneers at the other.
Man, you're weak, he says.
Please take a seat, gentlemen, says Mr. Bradshaw, gesturing to the only two open seats, which are, of course, right in front of me.
Where should we take our seats?
Says the other kid, then grabs the back of an empty chair and lifts it up.
Should we take them outside?
He's the paler one, and he's got this long, stringy blonde hair that looks like what happens when the grass dries out in the fields behind my house. Should I take notes on that? I think.
Yeah, let's go sit right outside the windows, says the tall kid.
Mr. Bradshaw's mouth curls up on one side. He doesn't exactly look happy. I glance over at Gracie, and she slams her notebook shut again and smiles.
Oh, okay.
As Mr. Bradshaw calls out our names and marks us down on his map of the classroom so he can do attendance more easily in the future, I learn that the almost late kids are Tommy Rodriguez and Walter May. Tommy flashes two peace signs when Mr. Bradshaw calls out his name.
That's me, he says. What are you gonna teach us, teacher?
Mr. Bradshaw frowns.
This is social studies, Mr. Rodriguez.
Dope, says Tommy. You gonna teach us about Twitter?
Our teacher narrows his eyes at Tommy.
What?
You know, says Tommy. Like, social media?
This is going to be a long year. There are so many other kids in the room. I don't catch all the names, but I know I'll remember Wunmi Onyebuchi, because hers is so great. She's got this gorgeous dark skin, and her hair is shaved down short all over. She even has on a Julie and the Phantom shirt, so I'm pretty sure she's cooler than me. Gracie's last name is Lim, and Mr. Bradshaw smiles at her.
Good to have you here, Gracie, he says. I've heard a lot about you.
Gracie goes red in the face. I have no idea what that means. Finally, after Tommy and Walter interrupt about 45 more times, I'm guessing, because I didn't actually take notes, Mr. Bradshaw introduces his class to us. He tells us that we're going to learn a little bit of history about the world, but we're also going to spend time
expanding our horizons. It's my job to teach you about this wonderfully diverse and complicated world, he explains, and I can't imagine a better way of doing that than assigning you homework.
I can't lie. Like everyone else in class, I groan when Mr. Bradshaw says that.
Homework? Already? Says Tommy.
Yes, already, says Mr. Bradshaw. But it's going to be an easy A. I believe everyone here can start the year off with a perfect score.
Gracie flips a few pages into her notebook to find a blank one, and I realize this must be it. It's time to take notes. I ready myself, my pen in my hand.
Each of you is going to introduce us to the cultures of your home, says Mr. Bradshaw.
My heart leaps.
You will give a short presentation, all oral, under 2 minutes, explaining what cultures make up your home and make you, you.
Wait.
Tell your fellow students about where you and your parents come from. Do you have interesting cultural practices or traditions in your home that you'd like to share?
My throat tightens, and I try to gulp down all the spit in my mouth, but I have to choke back a cough. Oh no. No, I don't want to do this.
I'll start,
continues Mr. Bradshaw.
My family is originally from Boston, and I was born outside Cambridge, Massachusetts. But my grandparents are actually from a place called Rotterdam, which is in the Netherlands, just south of Amsterdam. Have any of you been to Amsterdam?
There are a lot of head shakes, and a few kids softly mutter, no. I want to blurt out that most of us haven't even left California before. The Netherlands? I don't even know where that is on a map. That's not why my skin feels like it's being shocked with electricity, though. As Mr. Bradshaw talks about having Dutch heritage and all the kinds of food he ate growing up, I realize just how hard this is going to be. I'm not like any of these people because I was adopted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.